Characterizing aquifer properties is an important thing that we'll do in the field in hydrogeology. There are three main properties that we'll be interested in. Porosity, and really there are a variety of different types of porosity, hydraulic conductivity or permeability, and specific storage. Porosity is the volume of voids, the ratio of the volume of voids in a porous media to the total volume. There are primary and secondary types of porosity. We'll be interested in typical values of porosity. So one of the things that you should have, just as walking around knowledge, is an understanding of what typical values of porosity that might be expected. Also, we'll cover other types of porosity that are also related to the storage of water in porous materials. But they're somewhat different ratios, and they have different meanings. So degree of saturation, specific yield, specific retention, these are examples. And we'll also be interested in a type of porosity that's related to the flow, and in particular the velocity of water flowing through porous media, and that'll be called effective porosity. So those will be the things that we'll look at. Basically, the porosity is how water is stored in rock. It's the volume of voids in the rock to the total volume. And at its simplest sense, it's the space here between these grains of sand. But in more complicated material, you could have pores here in this rock, but then also these fractures would be pores that would be a larger scale. And we could take this one step further and assume that there's some kind of a dissolution process that causes a cavity like that. You could see here, there's a person in the pore space in this rock as a result of the dissolution process. So in order to have the term porosity really make any sense, we have to have a concept that we'll call the representative elementary volume. And basically, porosity and other properties that we'll use for describing porous media, these are average properties. And the reason we need to do that is because porous media is a complicated material at small scale. It has very complicated pore geometries, and we need to average out those complications. And so here's the way the concept works for porosity. If we imagine this is a solid grain, and this is filled with water here. This is then an idealized picture of a porous medium. And we could determine porosity as the ratio of the pore space to the total volume by taking a averaging region shown by the pink box, in which case we would have a porosity of roughly 50% or 0.5, where we use a scale here where porosity is zero. That would be zero pore space per unit total volume, and this would be all pore space. And so the pink box is 50%, but we can move that pink box around, and there it would be a much higher value. There it would be essentially zero, and we can move around there. There would be a 100% or a porosity of one. And so you can see that if our averaging region is that pink box, we can have porosities that vary between 0 and 1 depending upon where we put it. But if we make the box a little bit bigger, then we get a porosity that's right about there for that location of the box. There looks like it's a bit higher, more pore space in that box than in the other one. And we could move it there and get another value. And I think you see the pattern. If we move this thing around, we'll get a range of values, but it'll be a somewhat smaller range than we had with the smaller box. And so forth. So we would get something that looks like that. Now, if we have a bigger box, we get a porosity that's like that, and we move it around, and I think that you can see that the range of porosities that you would get would be smaller yet. And then at some point, we go up to a larger size box, and it doesn't really matter how we move it around, we get pretty much the same value of porosity. And so this box is called a representative elementary volume right there. And we're averaging the porosity within the box. we get this change of porosity with the size of the box that looks like this and kind of comes down like that and converges on a value here. So because it converges, that allows us to come up with a way to characterize porosity as a single number. And we see then that it's a single number when averaged over this REV size. And so that's an important concept to keep in mind really for all porous media, for all properties of porous media. So there's a graphic showing this envelope. Okay, so here are some examples of primary porosity. Primary porosity is the pore space that is in the rock at the time it was formed. So if we have a carbonate rock, here's the primary porosity. It's the space between these grains of carbonate material, some kind of a organism there, the pore space in these grains of sand. Here is in blue, this is the pore space that is remaining in this sandstone. You can see that the sandstone has been compacted, and the place where the grains are in contact, right there, for example, that grain contact has been dissolved away, and the grains are in places now completely in contact, and so it lost a good bit of pore space. And so the porosity is smaller than it used to be when the material was first deposited, but we still see some of this material remaining as what we would assume is the primary pore space. And then here's another example of basalt, and these vesicles in the basalt are the relics of gas bubbles that were there when the basalt cooled, and so that would be an example of primary porosity in basalt. It's possible to image the primary porosity in materials, and here's an example from sandstone where you can see the imprint of the grains right there. That there's a grain, and here these were circular grains that are not shown. And what's imaged here is the pore space itself. And so from a porosity perspective, we could take the volume of the imaged pore volume and the ratio of that to the volume of these cubes, and that's what we think of as porosity. This image gives us a little bit more detailed perspective on porosity at even a smaller scale. Primary porosity in limestone, it's a result of biological processes that are generating the limestone material. So here's a reef structure, and the way this reef develops, the way the organisms are growing, dictates the primary porosity. And if we look at this quarry in Florida and zoom in on the rock shown there, we can see the horizontal bands of porosity, and then structures like this are some kind of a critter that formed a calcium carbonate shell that was incorporated into the limestone, and this produces some, has the potential anyway, to produce some very high porosities in limestone. So secondary porosity is where the rock has been altered and modified after it has been formed. There are a variety of ways that this can happen, from fracturing or weathering, dissolution, and compaction. And here's some examples. This is a granite right here, and you can see the fracture with this aperture here of a millimeter or so, increasing the porosity, the secondary porosity in this case. And here's some more extensive fractures. This is a photomicrograph of a fracture, and you can see it's got some blue material in it to highlight it right there. And this is another fracture. This is actually down in Atlanta. And so this fracture is from around here, and it shows this kind of flat-lying feature that is going to be an important conduit for water in this area. There's also this vertical fracture right here. So we have with this system a conduit for water to move downward and then also laterally. But in a big picture, if we look at this really just at this scale, we could take the pore space that's in this fracture system, divide by this area, and get a porosity, a secondary porosity. Weathering also produces a secondary porosity. This is a granite that consists of feldspar minerals and some other things, and the feldspars are unstable at shallow depths, and so they weather out the clay, and this process dramatically increases the porosity of the material. Dissolution also increases porosity, particularly in carbonates. Here are some small bugs and cavities that are dissolved in limestone, and here's a big cavity, a conduit that's dissolved out. The Falarden limestone that we saw a few slides ago also is dissolved out. We start out with some fairly large primary porosity from the space between these different organism structures, and then you can see this feature here. Where it's been dissolved out and the porosity has been increased even more. Here is a large conduit dissolved in limestone. And clearly, in this vicinity, we have a very large secondary porosity as a result. Okay, so here are some things to remember. The typical values of porosity. This is good to just have in your working lexicon. Well-sorted sand. So this stuff, well sorted, means relatively narrow range of grain sizes. And what you typically see is a porosity in this range, 0.25 to perhaps as high as 0.5. I guess more on the low end is typical. If you reduce the sorting of the sand, then the overall range decreases and these values generally become smaller. Porosity of well-sorted sand or poorly sorted sand in this range. And I guess if you have to look at these two together, they overlap at around 0.2 porosity. So that might be just a good guideline for a ballpark estimate of porosity of sand, say 0.2. You just have to have one value. Now, clay has a much higher porosity in this range. Now we'll see that the permeability of clay is much less than sand, but the porosity is generally higher. And this is often a point of confusion because people often associate permeability or hydraulic conductivity with porosity. And in fact, in some cases they may be related, but in general they are not related. And this is a great example. Clays can have fairly high porosities. And that's because the grains in clays are kind of tabular or flat-lying plates, and they can be packed together like this, fairly loosely packed, and then all of the space between these grains can have water in it. So you can have quite a large amount of water per unit volume, and a high porosity is the result. Crystalline rock, the porosities are quite low. They are not, in fact, zero. So if you have a piece of granite, for example, nice fresh piece of granite, the porosity would be roughly in this range, maybe even a little bit higher than this. And this porosity is the space between the grains, the mineral grains in the rock material. As the minerals grow, they don't completely fill the space between them, and there's a bit of porosity that results. Now, if you take this crystalline rock and you fracture it, the porosity goes up as a result of the space that's formed by the fractures. And this is a typical range for fractured rock. Specific yield is important because it allows us to estimate the amount of water that might come out of a porous media due to gravity drainage. We can see how this works if we imagine that this rectangle here is a vessel that is filled with sand and completely saturated with water. So we fill this thing up with water, and then this would be like the water table up here. And we open a valve on this thing and let the water drain out. So the water level falls, and the water accumulates here in this vessel. So let's just see that again. The water level is dropping, and right there the water level is falling. So this is the water that's drained by gravity. There's also water that is left in the material, in this cylinder. It's held there by capillary forces, and it doesn't drain out. So if we take this volume of water that has drained by gravity, this volume here, and take the ratio of that volume to the total volume, which would be the volume of this sand-filled vessel, that ratio is called the specific yield. And if we use the volume of water that is retained inside the vessel and scale that to the total volume, that's the specific retention. So I think that it's clear that if we add together the volume of water that drained to the volume of water that's retained, this is the volume of water that didn't drain. So we add those two together, we just get the total volume of water. So if we add the specific yield and the specific retention, then we get the total porosity. And what that means is that so long as there's some water that's retained, the specific retention is not zero. And what that means is then that the specific yield will be somewhat less than the total porosity. In sands, it's slightly less. In materials that are fine-grained, like a clay, it could be very, very much less. You could have a clay where you drained it by gravity and very little water drained out at all. So, yeah, specific yield could be quite small in a material like that. So, to see a little bit more about how this works, let me draw a little sketch. And we're going to have water draining by gravity in a particular way. We're going to have this cube be sampling the aquifer over the water table. So there's the water table. And if we drop the water table from there to there, so there's the new water table, then we drop it like that. And we take this as the area. What's happened then is as the water table drops over this interval, this region drains by gravity. So initially, when the water table was up high, the pores here underneath the water table are all filled with water. And then when the water table drops to this new lower elevation, the pores above it drain out. Some of them do. And so that then would be the total volume of the aquifer drained. And that'll be equal to this area here in plan view and the times the delta H, the amount that the water table has dropped. So if we imagine then that as this drops, there's a certain amount of water that is no longer going to be in this block. So it's come out here and maybe it's accumulated in this cylinder. Maybe if you use your imagination, that's a cylinder. And so there's some volume in there. That's the volume of water that is drained out. So that would be that volume. And it's drained out by gravity, and it's drained out of this region here. So that's the total volume. That's A divided by delta H. So this is the volume that's drained per total volume, and that is another way to think about the specific yield. Okay, so that'll be important because it relates the specific yield to the volume that's released from storage in the field due to the change in the height of the water table. Okay, so if we keep that principle in mind, we can see how the water level in a well, or the water table might change in response to recharge. So, if we recall from the previous slide, the specific yield equals the volume that's drained out by gravity divided by the volume of region that has been drained. And this is the amount that the head has dropped, the water table has dropped due to this drainage process. So, the recharge, let's see, the water that is entering the aquifer. Let's draw a little sketch here of what I have in mind. So here's a block. Here's the water table. And now we have recharge coming in. And if we add some water, volume added per area of the aquifer in a map view, that's the amount of recharge that has come into this system. So if we, excuse me, so by that token, if we realize this is we can basically swap out the volume that's added with the volume that's drained, then the specific yield is it would be equal to this. It would be equal to the volume added per area per change in water level of the water, level of the water table. And we can combine these two to say that's the amount of recharge. Okay, so that's what I have here. The specific yield is the amount of recharge, the ratio of the amount of recharge to the change in head. Now, we can just simply rearrange this and get the change in head due to an amount of recharge. Okay, and we see then the specific yield shows up there. So what this means is that the specific yield is going to be less than the porosity, right? And we said that a typical value for porosity of sand might be 0.2. So say the porosity is 0.1, or the specific yield is 0.1, then the recharge will be equal to some value, and the change in the head of the aquifer, the water level, will be 10 times greater. So if we add in a certain amount of recharge here, if we add in 1 unit of recharge, the water level will change by 10 units. So this is that water level change is the amount of recharge divided by the specific yield. Okay, so this will be important because we'll be using wells for a variety of purposes, and we're interested in what the water level in that well means and what it means when that water level changes. And so here is a way to relate the change in water level to the recharge, and we see that the water level will change in the well by an amount that's much greater than the actual amount of recharge, and the amount that it is greater is determined by the specific yield. Okay, so here are some examples. Let's try these out. The water table in a well rises by 0.2 meters over a day following a period of heavy rainfall. So this is a recharge event, and we might imagine that if we plotted the head in the well as a function of time, it's going along like this, and then it rains and it jumps up like that. And so it's come up by 0.2 meters. And this is something that actually happens. So we ask then, if that occurs, how much recharge would we expect to have occurred to the aquifer if the specific yield is 0.5? So we saw that So R is equal to, we take the relation that we had on the other page, and we say R is equal to the head change, delta H, times the specific yield. And so if that's the case, then we have 0.05 times 0.2 meters. And that's going to equal 0.01 meters. Okay, so we have this much rise, 2/10 of a meter of rise, and this much specific yield, and the amount of recharge that we get is about 1 centimeter. Okay, so we can flip that around and we say, well, there's this much recharge that enters a karst aquifer with this amount of average porosity. Well, we should strike that. Let's say that specific yield. And how much will the water level rise in nearby wells? So delta H will be the R over the specific yield. So if we've got 10 centimeters going in, and it's 0.05 specific yield, then that will equal 200 centimeters of rise. Okay, 2 meters of rise of the water table. So that means that's actually quite a lot. One of the things, for example, that might be significant to is if you're in a karst aquifer, this is where caves occur. And so if you're down in a cave, one of the things that's kind of notorious amongst cavers is that it's possible for the water level in caves to rise quite quickly. And this is a reason why. You can have, if you were to have the water level rise by 2 meters, that could be the difference between being able to get out of the cave and being trapped in there. All right, so there's another porosity that involves the ratio of different volumes that's somewhat different than what we've seen. This is called the effective porosity, and it's the volume of pores that are important to flow. So this is kind of a vaguely stated thing, but we'll see how it works. It's that volume divided by the total volume. And the effective porosity, is used to go between flux and the average velocity of water in the pore space. Remember, we said that flux was the volumetric flow per unit area, or we can think of that as the volume of water in a unit of time in a unit of area. So we had a unit cross-section area like this. We've got some water that goes through that area. That's what we mean by flux. What we mean by velocity, though, is if we tag a little piece of water right here, so right there, that water is tagged. How rapidly is that tagged water moving along? What is the change in location as a function of time? Change in location per unit of time. That's what we mean by average velocity. And so we can relate those two by this way. The average velocity is equal to the flux divided by the effective porosity. Now, the average velocity is something that we'll be interested in if we want to know how long does it take for some water or perhaps contaminants in water that so long as the contaminants are moving with the velocity of the water, how long does it take them to go from point A to point B? In order to answer that, we need to know what the average velocity is. So we can take a form of Darcy's law, where we've got the head gradient, hydraulic conductivity, and if we divide that by the effective porosity, this gives us a way to estimate the average velocity in an aquifer. If we figure that this thing here, this effective porosity, it's the volume of pores important for flow to the total volume. So conceptually, we might just figure that the flow is going to really be using the large pores. So in any porous medium, there'll be a set of pores that'll be larger than the other ones, and that'll be the most important set of pores for flow. Now, if this difference is quite a lot, then there may be pores that don't really support flow at all. The water is pretty stagnant in those flows, or in those pores. So if we have a small subset of pores that are supporting flow, then the effective porosity might be significantly less than the total porosity. But in any case, I suppose that in some very idealized porous media, perhaps all the pores are contributing uniformly, in which case the effective porosity would be equal to the porosity. Generally, it's less, and in some cases, a lot less. But it's possible, I guess, to have the upper bounds be equal to the porosity. But if we take that, then we know that the porosity is going to be really rarely greater than 0.5, and in sands, say, it's probably more in the range of 0.2, 0.3. And so if that's 0.2 or 0.3, what it means is that the velocity of water in porous media will be greater than the flux. So when we use Darcy's law to calculate the flux, the velocity that the water is moving will be larger than that value. The units are the same. The units of flux are the same as the units of velocity, but they mean different things. And in general, the velocity is bigger than the flux. Okay, so here's another way of thinking about this. If we imagine that there's a pipe like so, and it's filled with water and flowing in that direction, then there's a volumetric flow rate. The volume per time that's flowing through that pipe is Q. And if we take then as the cross-sectional area, the area here, it's the total cross-sectional area of the pipe, then Q divided by the area total, that's a way of expressing the average velocity of flow in that pipe. So that concept hopefully is fairly straightforward. And I've just rewritten that here. Okay, so we can take this expression here and we can write that like this. The ratio of the volumetric flow rate to the total area, this total area here, and you take that and multiply by that, by the ratio of the total area to the area that provides flow, that allows flow. And we can see that these two are the same because this would cancel that, and then this would be equal to this thing over here. Okay? But we introduce this. This is a sort of a form of the chain rule. And we introduce it because this we recognize as the flux. That's how we define the flux, the volumetric rate divided by the total cross-sectional area through which the flow is occurring. And this is the area total divided by the area through which flow is occurring. And if we say that the area total, A total, is, well, this ratio, area total to area flow, is going to be essentially the same as V total to V flow, volume, then this thing here is 1 over the effective porosity. That's equal to the flux. So this is how we can conceptualize how the velocity is related to the flux through the effective porosity. Okay, now as it turns out, measuring this, the area that allows flow or the volume that allows flow, as it turns out, measuring that volume independently is really a bit of a trick. And instead, the way that it's done is to measure the flux using some kind of a Darcy's law calculation or experiment, and then also measure the velocity. And that's done using a tracer test, typically, where you can mark some water and see how long it takes to travel a certain distance. And so if you know the flux and you know the velocity, then you can take the average, or you can take the ratio and determine the effective porosity. Okay, so that's typically how this thing is measured. Okay, so we also said that we would be interested in travel times. And this will have some important implications if we're interested in estimating how long does it take water or contaminants that are moving with the water to move from point A, say a place where the contaminants might be released, to point B, say a place where the contaminants could do some harm. So we want to estimate that travel time, and we can do it by estimating the flux using the effective porosity to calculate the average velocity. And then we can take the average velocity and the distance and use them to calculate what the travel time would be. So here's a little sketch of how we would do it. So velocity, in just a general term, is the amount of displacement or the movement of a particle by some distance, delta L, in a certain time. So we can rearrange that and write it like this. The time that it takes is equal to that distance divided by the average velocity. And we could expand that out by saying there's the distance of travel, and here's the hydraulic head gradient, the hydraulic conductivity, and the effective porosity. So if we know all of those things and we know the distance, we can calculate then the travel time. Well, we've seen that we can measure the head gradient. If we can measure the head in the aquifer, we can do a three-point problem and determine the gradient and the direction of flow. We could estimate what the effective porosity is, and then we need to have some way to estimate the hydraulic conductivity. But if we do, then we could go and do this calculation. So that gives us a path forward. It'll give us some motivation for trying to come up with what the hydraulic conductivity is. Let's do a simple example here. So if the horizontal flux is that value, and I think that was about what we calculated in a previous video, 0.01 meters per day, and if the effective porosity is 0.05, what's the average velocity and how long would it take for water to go 100 meters? 100 meters, you know, that's long enough so that perhaps the water could start off at some kind of a source area and end up traveling far enough to go someplace where it might cause some difficulties. So let's go ahead and try that. So the velocity is equal to the flux divided by the effective porosity. So that'll be this, 0.1 meters per day divided by 0.05. And that equals 0.2 meters per day. That's the velocity. So the travel time that's given up here, that's the distance, in this case 100 meters, divided by the velocity, 0.2 meters per day. And the units cancel here, that gives us 500 days. So that's, what, about a year and a half, something like that. That's, I don't know, slow by some standards, but that's pretty quick by other standards. It would be common, for example, to have that much time elapse between when some contaminants had been released and now. So anyway, that's how you go about doing this calculation. One thing too that I would point out, whenever I do calculations, I always use a grid like this. I always have just one fraction, so just terms in the denominator and numerator. I never would have a fraction down here and a fraction up here or a fraction up here. And I always write out the units and, like I did here, cancel the units out. If you do it this way, these are simple problems and you might be able to do these without drawing it out like this. But I always do it this way, even if it's a simple problem. It allows you to check the units, and it just makes a formal way to construct the problem that prevents you from making some simple mistakes, or at least it lowers the odds of making some simple mistakes. Simple mistakes are always something that will happen, but you want to do whatever you can to lower the odds, and this way of writing out problems is a good way to lower them.